All right, the last two things that we discussed when we're talking about corks and the standard model is the principle of cork confinement. So when we discovered corks by smashing atoms together, we've never actually seen a cork by itself. We see them as parts of particles, okay? So we either see them as baryons or mesons. And the idea comes from the fact that if I try to pull apart, so here's a meson, I got a cork and an anti-quark, okay? And if I try to pull them apart, as I'm pulling them apart, it takes an incredible amount of energy to pull them apart because they're held together by a strong force. But as I pull them apart, eventually, if I do break it, another quark just appears. It'll never be by itself. So then I end up making mesons. If I break apart a meson, I'll just make more mesons, as you can see in the diagram over here. So quark confinement basically states that quarks can never be found alone, they can only be found as part of particles, hadrons, mesons. Okay, they can never be on their own. All right, and here's an example of a quark and anti-quark pair in a meson. They have incredible strong force interactions between them that are mediated by exchange particles called gluons. All right, so you need an incredible amount of force to pull them apart, and as you do pull them apart, another quark will materialize from gluons. The last particle, exchange particle, that got a lot of excitement is the Higgs particle. And the Higgs particle, and here you can see a result of an explosion where we bring two nuclei together, we smash them together with high energy, and that energy is making a sea of particles. And all these circles are just different charged particles and different masses of charged particles. Everything that has a different radius represents a different mass in a magnetic field. So they would take a snapshot, and then they would look at all the different radii and all the patterns. Some are going down, some are going up, which means that some are positively charged, some are negatively charged. And they would look at all those, and they would be able to estimate the energy or the mass of each of those particles, okay? So the Higgs particle is a massive particle, has a lot of energy, that defines the mass interaction. So what is mass? We can understand charge, we can understand spin, we can understand all these other quantum properties, but what gives matter mass? And the idea is the Higgs particle is what gives matter mass. And so any formula that has a relationship between mass, such as gravity or resistance, must be mediated by interactions between Higgs particles. So air resistance is a good example, like buoyancy, density, all that stuff. As I fall through water, okay, I will experience resistance. Well, that could be because my body is spitting out Higgs particles and interacting with other matter of mass, all right, causing interactions that slow me down. So the Higgs particle is an exchange particle that is responsible for mass, and it is massive. All right, that might appear on a multiple choice question. So after going through all these videos and reading the text, right now, the best thing you can do is go through the test yourself questions at the end of the chapter, just to make sure you can answer and draw the structures of mesons and baryons and answer some of these conservation laws and do some of these Feynman diagrams. Once you've gone through that, I think you're prepared for the 3 or 4 mark questions. I wouldn't spend more than 2 days on this stuff at all, okay, because it's not the majority of your exam. It's just a small component of it. But you definitely want to walk in there with a little bit of knowledge so that in case it does pop up, you're able to put a few answers down and hopefully get some marks for it.